Hello colleagues, this is Arda again from Weekly Series, and today we are going to discuss one of our recent articles, namely Flow-Oriented Layout Revisited. As you may remember from the original Lean series, we had discussed on FOL a little bit, but we were more focused on how to teach the method than the actual details of the method. So we will try to cover this part as well in this article. FOL is a very critical tool and it is very decisive in the success of a shop floor. But it is not a frequent tool. I mean, you don't often use it in a facility like monthly basis or it is sometimes even less frequent because it is not very possible to continuously change the layout of your organization. So you should get the most out of it when you apply FOL. And before you start any FOL study, any FOL workshop, you should first try to analyze your facility with a block layout. So in this way, you see which logical parts or divisions your facility have and how they react with each other in terms of material flow. In this study, you should divide your facility in the most common sense way, which stations can go with which others, etc., because you will create these parts like Lego parts in the block layout, and you will use these Legos to rebuild your facility in a more flow-oriented fashion. So you should analyze, understand the logic behind it, and how your facility operates in daily life, and use this information in the block layout to use them and to build into a new version of your facility, which is much more efficient and less free. Once you do this, maybe we should go a little bit deeper on why we are doing FOL, why flow orientation in a facility is important. There are two mainly different parts of orientation in a physical layout. So one of them is the process orientation, which is a classical version, and the other is the one we are talking, the product orientation. The process orientation is coming from more or less a classical version of production management, where you divide certain distinct different departments and you combine the same machinery, same process equipment into that department, and the parts go from one department to another, and the focus is not on the part or its travel to the final destination, but rather how you use the resources in this each different department. And how you utilize the efficiency, how you create the efficiencies of these parts in these departments. So when you go in such a shop floor and ask the supervisor of, for instance, the delivery department, how things are going, he will simply respond like saying how many parts he drilled that day, or the total utilization of the machinery or the operators, etc. But he will not have any clue on where the parts go after he drilled the parts, or whether today they were used in a shipment or they have been shipped as a total part to a customer. These are not his concern. His concern is how much utilization he got and how many parts he drilled that day. So this is a mindset that is coming from the classical version of production management. And as you know, in Lean, in flow orientation, the focus is not on individual island departments. The focus is on the overall flow of products from the start position to the final process, and then, of course, as a final delivery to the customer. So when you change the physical layout of your facility from process orientation to product orientation, you actually focus to have a very easy, very straight physical movement of parts between different processes. And in this way, you focus on eliminating waste like transportation, unnecessary handling, working process, total lead time, etc. So in product orientation, the focus is on the product itself, how much road it traveled, whether it reached to the customer or not. And this is more or less a better version of your facility. So in a product-oriented facility or a flow-oriented facility, you will most probably see certain lines of processes or subsequent processes that aim to produce a product family or a product. But to an extent, of course, because you may not always have the luxury of maybe dividing or duplicating certain stations of creating low utilization because of costs. So you may still end up seeing certain stations as central stations that use that is being commonly used between different lines of production. But still, the more we evolve from process orientation to product orientation, the better we eliminate the waste we have inherent to our manufacturing. So having said that, what defines the extent? In each FOL study, you will end up with different layout alternatives. So you need to be able to select which one is better than the other in terms of a certain selection criteria. So you have a certain set of criteria that you are going to use in this evaluation process. This can be intralogistics, the traffic, the monuments, which I mean as stations or areas that in a factory that is very difficult to move. It can be highly, highly costly or technically very difficult or impossible sometimes. Sometimes the logistics areas also may be constrained. Safety measures, total distance, materials travel, which is the transport cost, the cost of implementation, the alternative, the time of implementation, the alternative. These are all valid selection criteria, and there can be many more that you can use to evaluate these different alternatives. But coming from an industrial engineering point of view, I like to think of this as a more of an optimization problem, because my main concern in many of our studies is actually eliminating waste. So let us take this as an example of optimizing or minimizing the transportation waste under a set of constraints for my facility. If I am successful in transforming this kind of a method to a mathematical understanding, then I can easily optimize the location of my processes. So I simply set up an easy example on Excel sheet. So let us think that this is our layout of our facility, and as you may see in the article, we had set some of these processes in different certain locations in the layout. So this is my current placing of my processes in the layout. So in this practical example, we have got the layout here, and these some of our processes have already been located. And as you can see, we have got a transport times a load figure. The load can be in terms of pallets, boxes, etc. A common unit that you can identify the total transfer load, total transfer units we can use. So once you set this table, you also need to check the different distances between different locations. Here the locations are defined as axes. So you set up a table like this where you see the distances, and also you can see the number of pallets or boxes transported between different processes is a table as well. And you set up this route times load table. Once you do it, you can solve this problem as an integer programming problem by simply setting which process should be located in which physical location as a 1 or 0, as a binary variable, and also put some constraints like one selection of each process. To be all processes should be located in the layout, and there should be one location for each process, etc. You can set these constraints, and you can solve this problem with the data solver in the exam, and you set the minimization of the objective is of a top priority, and you are going to change the variables, which are the integer variables that you select the location of these different processes, and you have got many constraints here, as we have mentioned. And I'm using the evolutionary method algorithm, which is a different algorithm. You can see the details in Excel support groups, etc. So once you hit the solve button, it will try to find an alternative optimum to your selection. It takes a little bit of a while. The evolutionary algorithm tries to find out the best subset of a solution by simply trying different alternatives. There are lots of alternatives, as you can see in this example, and it is trying to come up with a better alternative that you have. And there are certain places in the Excel where you can set different parameters to this algorithm and find out a better or a more convenient result in terms of your constraints, in terms of your locations, in terms of your processes, in terms of your distances, and in terms of the total load to be transferred between different processes. So this can take a while based on the number of constraints you have, number of locations you have, the number of processes you have. Once Excel finds a solution, it says Solar found a solution, all constraints and optimal conditions are satisfied, and you simply click OK to keep the result. So here in the article, as you can see, we have created these solution alternatives. Basically, after this is done, the solver puts these solutions into different physical locations. And from our starting point of 167 transport ways, the solver finds a solution of 90, which is a 45% improvement in terms of physical location and transport, physical location related transport waste. Of course, in real life, selection criteria and alternative considerations can involve much more complex points. However, as you can see in this example, there is always room for improvement. So thank you all for watching me in this YouTube channel video, and hope to see you in the next video, and bye-bye.